The rules of the infirmary stated that persons who suffered from incurable diseases could not be admitted. This would naturally have included all forms of insanity. However, there are examples of people with mental illness being admitted. One such person was Mary Jones, who lived in the foundry in San Rhaeadr. She was admitted in the early 1840s, having been an outpatient at the dispensary 15 years earlier. Since then, she had been confined to a small chamber above the forge, where she was found in a deplorable state. In order to allow her admission to the infirmary, it was necessary for Dr. Richard Lloyd Williams and Dr. Cumming to declare that she was not insane. It is said that this episode played a significant part in influencing the British Parliament in enacting lunacy laws to protect the plight of the mentally ill. Both Dr. Cumming and Dr. Lloyd Williams had a particular interest in the plight of the mentally ill, and in a meeting held at the infirmary in October 1842, it was decided that an asylum for the mentally ill should be built in the area. Joseph Ablett, an infirmary committee member, donated 20 acres of land for this purpose, and the North Wales County's Lunatic Asylum, as it was then called, was opened in 1848. Unfortunately, Joseph Ablett died in 1847 before its completion. Dr. Arthur Edward Turner, a native of Staffordshire, was appointed surgeon in 1850 at the age of 31. He lived at Grove House, now known as Agessi on Vale Street. This painting, showing the infirmary in the distance, was painted in the 1850s. It is said that the rider in the picture is Dr. Turner. He was intimately involved with the hospital for over 40 years and became mayor of Denbigh in 1862 and 63. In 1889, he was presented with his portrait, painted by the highly esteemed German-born artist Sir Hubert von Herkomer. Herkomer, a Bavarian by birth, was responsible for designing the regalia for the National Eisteddfod of Wales. By the late 1840s, the infirmary had become very overcrowded. The laundry was housed in the cellars of the building, and much of the work had to be conducted in the waiting room. Indeed, such was the demand on space that the mangle was located in the kitchen. Given this unsatisfactory state of affairs, further extensions were planned and completed in 1851. In 1858, Dr. Evan Pierce Williams was appointed surgeon. He was the nephew of Dr. Evan Pierce, whose memorial gardens can be seen on Vale Street in Denbigh. It is perhaps something of a mystery that Evan Pierce, who by all accounts was regarded with great esteem in the town, was never to become physician at the infirmary, his application for the post having been refused on no fewer than three occasions. It is said that in answer to this rebuke, Dr. Pierce established his own small hospital in his home, the now demolished Salisbury Place on Vale Street. a number of patients with alcohol problems were accommodated there. Dr. Pierce Williams predeceased his uncle, and both are buried, with other family members, at St. Marcella's Church in Denbigh. Raising funds was always a priority for the institution. In 1862, a concert was given by Llywelyn Lewis, known as Lleo Llwyfa, a well-known singer, poet, novelist and raconteur. It raised over £15. Sadly, he was to die in abject poverty in Rhyl in 1901, after many years of illness. Thomas G, the eminent publisher, was elected a member of the management committee in 1878 at the age of 63. He was a devout Calvinistic Methodist and visited the infirmary every Sunday evening, where he would conduct a service for the patients. It is said that he would often return home to Bale Street, fast asleep on his horse Degum. He would eventually be succeeded by his son Howell in 1898. Like all voluntary hospitals, raising money was a constant necessity. Grand balls were held annually to raise funds, usually in the county hall. The earliest were in the 1820s. They continued well into the 1940s. A notice from 1899 tells us that dancing was to commence at 10 o'clock precisely. In 1886, the committee acknowledged that some patients could not afford the 6 shillings a week for their inpatient care. Dr. Turner, the senior medical officer, recognised this more than anyone and donated 1,000 guineas in order to provide 3 free beds. They would be called the Turner free beds. Over the coming years, many more free beds would be provided at the infirmary. A brass plaque was hung above the occupied bed. This rather public display of the patient's poverty would no doubt be frowned upon today. Elsie Williams, who first started work at the infirmary in 1937, remembers these plaques.
Yes, I do. I don't know when they went off. They must have gone off when the health service, everything changed, you know. They were all on the beds, on the wall. If people were poor, they didn't mind who knew. It's so different now, you know.
Nice people with nice manners, but got no money at all. They've got such nice habits, they keep rabbits, but got no money at all. Their father keeps their mother keeps their brother, and when they're running short of cash, they borrow from each other, 'cause they're nice people with nice manners, but got no money at all. If you have a pedigree, mix in high society, you will cultivate a lot of fame. But I know a family never had a pedigree, but they have a most distinguished name. They call them
nice people
with nice manners, but got no money at all.
In 1900, 6 beds were offered to the War Office for soldiers invalided home from the Boer War, some of whom are shown here in Lenton Pool. Entries in the admission book show that many wounded and diseased soldiers from the First World War were also cared for at the infirmary. There was interaction with military convalescent homes, such as Ystradisa on the outskirts of the town. Matron Picton Davis was replaced by Enid Ellis in 1902. This photograph, taken outside the main entrance, shows Miss Ellis with a group of colleagues. Her sister, Bertha Ellis, was appointed head nurse at the same time. In 1908, the house known as Park View, adjoining the infirmary grounds, was purchased. Although originally intended as a residence for the matron, it in fact served as a nurse's home for many years. Matron Carruthers was appointed in the same year. X-ray apparatus was installed in 1914, and in 1915, some 600 men who were quartered in Denbigh were given vaccinations. King George V and Queen Mary, accompanied by Princess Mary, visited the infirmary on Thursday, the 16th of July, 1920. They called after formally opening Llangwyfan Hospital, then a sanatorium. The infirmary visit almost failed to take place, the royal car having returned straight to Denbigh Station, where the royal train was waiting. Fortunately, the oversight was noticed, and the royal party returned in their car to Park Street and into the infirmary. They signed the visitor's book in the boardroom, where the Queen is said to have shown great interest in the portrait of Dr. Turner. In 1922, Sister Sophia Patterson, who had been a sister at the infirmary since 1920, was appointed matron. Here, she is seen playing tennis with her future husband in Mr. McConnell. The court was situated at the front of the infirmary grounds, where the porter's lodge was later built. Matron Patterson qualified at Liverpool in 1918, and her registration certificate was issued in 1922 by the newly formed General Nursing Council. In 1923, the infirmary was approved as a training school for nurses in affiliation with Chester Royal Infirmary. A hospital badge was created for those who qualified at the infirmary. In 1925, new honorary medical officers were appointed, including Dr. Donald Gordon Duff and Dr. John Griffith Thomas. Dr. Duff, who lived at Plas Piggott, directly across the road from the infirmary, served the hospital for over 20 years before returning to take up a post in Fort William in Scotland. He was a keen mountaineer and devised a special mountain rescue stretcher which was taken on the Everest expedition of 1953. Dr. Duff is seen here driving his car along the Horseshoe Pass. He died in Oban in 1968. Dr. John Thomas, by any standards, was quite a character.